You are now tuned in to the network. The YouTube channel that takes complex networking topics and dumbs it down to a more simpler language. And today's topic is a whole bunch of them. Two-tier, three-tier, spine and leaf, WAN, small office, home office, or SOHO, not the section in New York City, on-premises and cloud. These are characteristics that we're going to describe of network topology architectures. This is a topic in the CCNA exam code, I believe it's 200-301. Let's go ahead and take a look at the exam blueprint to see where we came from and where we're headed. All right, so this is the exam blueprint right here. CCNA exam version 1.0, 200-301. Don't be alarmed here. I know we are covering a whole bunch of topics in this video, but we're just gonna race through these topics. And notice it says, again, describe these characteristics. So we're just gonna be describing these characteristics. I don't believe we need to kind of do any kind of hands-on. We just need to see what the architecture looks like. There's no like commands we got to learn or anything like that. We just need to kind of describe it for the sake of passing the exam, really. You know, if you want to, maybe if y'all want me to, maybe I could put some labs up and we can kind of like, discover the network, these type of network topologies. But for the most part, we just need to kind of know what they look like and what lies on each of these network topology architectures contain. Let's go ahead and start off with the different layers of a what Cisco calls best practice design. There's the three tier and the two tier. I was going to start off with just talking about with just those two, but there's other network topologies that are sort of similar, and we might as well just talk about all of them. That's why I said I'm going to go ahead and lump all of these up in one video. So first of all, let's talk about, if you look at this right here, this is kind of a spoiler alert here, because we have kind of all the layers lumped all in here in this video right here, or in this slide right here. But we're going to focus for this right here. We're going to start off at the bottom, right? Started from the bottom, we are here. So let's focus on the access layer right here. This is here at the bottom. What's that defined as? Access switches connect directly to end users. So we've got these guys right here. These are our access switches, right? And then we got these endpoints right here, which are our users, right? Providing user device access to the LAN or local area network. Access switches normally send traffic to and from the end user devices to which they are connected to and sit at the edge of the LAN. We talked about what endpoints are, right? These endpoints, these guys right here, the desktops, PCs, the tablets, right? They're also known as what? End stations, hosts, nodes. There's so many synonyms to these end devices, right? Well, they all lie at the access layer. They connect to the access switches, which all this lumped together at the bottom are the access layer. Typically, we just find, like I said, end user traffic. You'll see some, control messages like CDP messages and things like that. But you're not going to find access control lists and stuff like that. But typically, you're just going to see mostly end user traffic at this layer right here. The next layer is the distribution layer. So we're just going to kind of like move up the ladder right here, right? They're called different tiers, right? But this layer right here is the distribution layer. Now, I know you might see a different network topology in the official cert guide, right? But I like this example right here because it lumps all of them together, and it's a clear distinction of all of the layers right here. The distribution layer provides an aggregation point for access switches, right? So we have our access switches right here, right? Right? And then they connect to the distribution layer. This provides connectivity to the rest of the devices in the LAN, forwarding frames between switches. So the distribution layer, we got this link right here, that link right there, that link right there, right? You're going to see only traffic from switches to switches. You're not going to see a user connected to the distribution layer. Unless you're like the IT guy who's, consoled into this switch right here, then he's pretty much kind of, I guess, in a sense, as a user. But typically, you're not going to see endpoints or end devices on the distribution layer. What you're going to see is other switches. That's why they call it the distribution layer, because it takes the traffic from the other switches, sends it off to other switches. That's what the distribution layer consists of. So forwarding frames between switches, as it says right here, but not connecting directly to end user devices. Note that most designs use at least two uplinks to different distribution, say that five times, two uplinks to two different distribution switches for redundancy. So for example, we got this switch right here, right? This is, let's call him switch one, right? He has a link to that distribution switch, and he also has a link to that distribution switch. So if this distribution switch right here goes down, he still has connectivity. These guys still have connectivity to the internet, right? So it would take for both of them to go down for us to completely go down. That's the reason why we create two uplinks to distribution switches, so that way we'll have redundancy. That's what redundancy is for. so that way we have more uptime and it's less likely for the entire network to go down. The core layer, as you can see, we're moving up one more up the ladder right here, right? We got the core layer right here, which is highlighted in yellow, this guy right here, right? The core layer is defined as switches that aggregates distribution switches. So basically, we're taking all the traffic from the distribution layer and aggregating that traffic in a very large campus LAN. You're not going to see this type of, you're not going to really see this layer in say, you know, a remote office or something like that, or a small home office network. We'll talk about that kind of network as well. But you're going to typically see this in very large campus LANs, like a school or, you know, a large, you know, hospital system or something like that, providing very high forwarding rates for the larger volume of traffic due to the size of the network. So a core layer, you're going to see them type of switches. Let me pull up an example here. So we go to Cisco's website right here. We got a Cisco switch selector right here. If we just go to this link right here, I'll leave a link, this link in the description below. We just type in core. Here's a popular, pretty much one of their standard switches right here. So this would be an example of a core switch right here. So as you can see, you know, it handles a lot of throughput right here. This is what you would consider port density, a lot of ports that takes all of this traffic and aggregates it, right? So that's why we need fast switches for core switching. We view the data sheet right here. We can see, you know, there's more port options. You could add, you know, you could add more line cards, right? There's fan redundancy. You'll see there's a lot of power redundancy. You'll see a lot more right here at the bottom. We've got a lot more power supplies. So one goes down, we have another one. We have redundancy for the fans, for the power, you know, all kind of environmental components of the switch. So this is typically what you'll see as a core layer switch. So again, this is the core layer right here. And you notice right here, we've got a couple lines right here, right? So these are obviously our interfaces, right? And we have this circle right here, usually in a circle like this that go across the lines, indicates like either some sort of aggregation technology, like VSS, something switching. I can't remember what it stands for. If y'all know the answer to that, that's y'all pop quiz for today. What does VSS stand for? Put that in the comments below. But you'll also see something like this, ether channel or port channels. They are indicated by a circle like this over these many lines right here, because it takes all of that and kind of bundles them all in one. You know, it aggregates those ports there. So, and it just makes it, it's a lot more faster and there's a lot more throughput that you can handle right here. So, and we also do this for redundancy. In case one link goes down, we still got three more right here, right? Another thing about the core layer switch, we'll notice there's redundancy between the core layer and the distribution layer. So let's say this is core two, right? He has a link to distribution switch number one. He also has distribution switch number two. So if core layer two switch goes down, right? These guys still have connection to those guys right there. So if this again was core two right here, right? And then he has a link to the distribution layer and this distribution layer, right? These guys connect to that layer right here, right? But if this guy goes down, right? Or say this link right here goes down, we still have traffic. All these guys can still get to that layer, that core layer right here, through this switch right here. Right, so even if that link right there goes down, that's what redundancy is for. It creates multiple paths, so that way, you know, we have a higher uptime. Like I said, this was a spoiler alert because there's a three-tier design and there's the two-tier design. So I want to start off talking with the three-tier design, because obviously there's the first layer, the second layer, and this third layer, right? Access layer, distribution layer, and the core layer. Don't get this confused with the OSI model, where we got layer one, layer two, layer three, all the way to layer seven, right? These are not layer one, two, and three, or anything like that. This is access layer, distribution layer, and the core layer. This is also known as the, you know, Cisco's three-tier hierarchy design. You know, some people call it the best practices design, whatever they want to call it. As you can see right here, when you look in the official cert guide, it says, if you look up for three design, or three-tier design, it says see the core design. You go to core design, it says core design is a campus LAN design that connects access switches, these guys right here, to distribution switches, to these guys right here, and distribution switches into the core switches, these switches right here, to provide a path between all LAN devices. So basically, it's just like roads and highways and stuff like that. We try to create multiple paths to get somewhere. That's basically what it basically, you know, this type of design is for. So we can create redundancy, and there's still ways to get to the internet. Now, this is in contrast to the two-tier design. You guessed it. We're missing one layer here, right? So you look at this topology right here. What are we missing? Pause it and think about it. Don't think you need to be a genius to figure this out, right? Because we have got the access layer right here, right? We got the distribution layer right here, right? What are we missing, right? The core layer, right? So essentially, what is the two-tier design? What advantages does this have? Well, you look in the official cert guide, it says two-tier design. See the collapsed core design definition. You look up that definition, it says collapsed core is a campus land design in which the design does not use a separate set of core switches in addition to the distribution switches, in effect collapsing the core into the distribution switches. So essentially, the distribution layer right here would be considered our core layer slash distribution layer. That's why they call it collapsed core, because they take the core, collapse it into the distribution layer. And notice we still got redundancy here. So let's say these two links right here go down, right? These guys right here that are connected to access layer switch number two, they can still get to the internet this way by going that way and then going to the router this way, right? Let's say that one stays, right? But then this one goes out. We still got a way to get to the internet by going this way, right? So on and so forth. We're creating redundancy here. The only difference is we would use this to, like, you know, for a smaller design, not necessarily one that's like that spans across a whole, you know, I don't know, city or something like that. You'll typically see something like this in, like, maybe say like one building or something like that, where we don't really have a core switch. We just have the distribution layer. It takes us out to the internet. Because you know, a lot of times you'll have these distribution switches that can also handle routing as well. So they're not just layer two switches. They also handle layer three routing as well. Even though right here we've got a router right here and a router right here. So typically you may keep this as a layer two switch and just keep make these guys have like a default route to router two and router one. And then that takes us out to the internet. So the spine and leaf technology, or excuse me, topology, is a single site network topology in which endpoints connect to the leaf switches connect to all spine switches. But without reading all this, basically it's the same thing, except that they consider the spine switches kind of like the distribution layer. And then the leaf switches obviously are like the access layer switches. So as you can see right here, the leaves are at the bottom right here. They're connected to the spine because it's like the backbone of the network, right? That's why they call it spine versus leaf. They also call this, the Claus design. It was named after this guy named Charles Claus. He was like some kind of, I don't even remember what he did. But basically, you know, he kind of designed the spine and leaf type of network topology. And this is typically what you'll see in like in a data center because, you know, the traffic it creates redundancy for all of our, you know, switches and stuff like that. And you'll have higher throughput for these designs right here as well. The resulting topology results in predictable switching paths with three switches between any two endpoints that connect to different leaf switches. So not only we have like, it's kind of like way more redundancy. Remember the other one, we had a minimum of two uplinks, right? So let's take leaf number one, right? Leaf switch number one right here, right? He's got an uplink to this spine. He got an uplink to that spine. That's two, right? He also got an uplink to this spine, right? So again, this is redundancy here. Let's say this link right here goes down. He still got a way to get to the internet by going to the other two paths right there, right? It's just that there's way more redundancy as opposed to just like the three-tier and the two-tier technology. They just try, it's like more redundancy. You'll see beefier switches in this type of network topology. Another thing that you want to know is that each leaf switch must connect to every spine switch, as we see right here, right? And every spine switch, so let's say, for example, spine one, right? He connects to that switch, that leaf switch, that leaf switch, and also that leaf switch. So every spine switch connects to all of the leaf switches, right? Leaf switches cannot connect to each other, as you can see right here. So leaf one, obviously is not connecting to leaf two, but he can still get to leaf two, right? How? He go to the spine switch and he gets to the leaf switch that way, right? Spine switches cannot connect to each other as well. This switch right here, obviously spine number one, he does not connect to spine number two. However, his traffic can get to spine two. How? He go to the leaf switch and get to the other leaf switch. Last thing is, endpoints connect to only the leaf switches. So this is why I said it's very similar to the 2-to-3-tier design. This is more of a 2-tier design, right? Because we don't have end users connected to the spine switches. So unless, of course, you're the IT guy and you're in the network closet and your switches go down, or you know, you got some kind of remote access problem, then we've got the IT guy. He's gonna obviously be consoled into that switch and, you know, and try to take care of the spine switch right there. But other than that, you're typically not gonna see end users on the spine switches. You're only going to see them on the leaf switches. And that's indicated by these little sticks right here. Let's move on to a wide area network. I think we talked about this in the router video, which is section 1.1, if I'm not mistaken, where we discussed the differences between LANs and WANs, right? We talked about how we put them together, and it's basically the internet, right? Well, the WAN is wide area network. That's that what it stands for. Something also my daughter does when she's crying. It operates beyond geographic scope of a LAN. We said what a LAN is, right? Local area network. So if this right here is the local area network, right? When we need to go out to the internet, basically, we going this way, we're going to the WAN. WANs are used to interconnect enterprise LANs to remote LANs in branch sites and telecommunicator sites. So basically, the WAN is kind of the glue to the LANs, right? And remember, we said the internet or the network all together are basically LANs and WANs put together. Simply put, y'all know how we do on this channel. We take things and simplify it. Obviously, it gets deeper than that, but when you're looking at this network topology right here, it can be a little, you know, daunting or a little, you know, intimidating by you when you're looking at it, right? But really, we've got WANs that connect together our LANs. So this is our enterprise network right here, right? Yes, it's an enterprise, it's a work group right here. We got a building backbone, we got a campus backbone, but at the end of the day, that is a LAN. And these remote sites, this is another LAN. So we got a LAN connected to the WAN. So when this LAN needs to talk to another network, which is typically what the internet is, this LAN needs to go to the WAN, and then you need to get to the other LAN that way. That's basically, simply put, small office home network, or SOHO. SOHO is the abbreviation of small office home office architectures. This architecture is the simplest network architectures that is mainly used in homes or small enterprises, as its name implies. So you go, you know, if you don't know too much about networking, you just look at the stuff that you got at home. Most likely it's going to be something similar to this right here. You're going to have your Wi-Fi router or router connected to a modem, and that take you out the internet. Simply put, it's just two devices. Sometimes they take these devices and compile them all into one device, right? You'll have I'll show you an example. This is a perfect example right here. We got like these Aeris modems. We got these, Cisco DOCSIS modem. Basically, they take functionalities of a Wi-Fi access point, a switch, and a router all in one device. That way, it simplifies it for you, right? Where you ain't gotta have three separate devices. At home, that's why you ever wonder, I used to wonder at home, like, why come at home, we don't have the same thing as I do at like work? There's a separate switch, there's a separate router. Well, it just kind of simplifies it. They just put all them devices into one, and that's a similar example of these devices right here. So when we take a look at this network topology right here, right, we got this Wi-Fi router that's connected to this pretty much a modem right here. So this device will be considered the modem. It's also the Wi-Fi, as you can see this lady right here. She's connected wireless. This printer right here, they all look like they wireless, even though this guy's on the desktop PC. Where's my wires right here, right? But anyways, they all connect to this Wi-Fi router right here. This guy connects to the modem, and they get to the internet. Simply put, that's basically how a SOHO network is. Here's another example of a SOHO network. We got these, this work group right here, these desktop PCs. They're connected wirelessly, connected to the access point. These guys are on the landline right here. They're connected to the switch. Essentially, they all get to the switch. They connect to the router, and then they connect to the modem, obviously, and they get to the internet. But like I said, those devices that you get from like Spectrum or Comcast, whatever, they take all these devices and lump them all into one device, like the ones that I showed you in the previous, or that I Googled for y'all. We've got the on-premises and cloud network architecture right here, right? I left this little, y'all just keep skip this bullet point right here. A public cloud provider offers services, selling those services to consumers in other companies, right? So, well, let's talk about on-premise first, right? This is just typically what you would see on most environments, or at least corporate environments, where their data center is on-site. So we've got all of our, you know, our databases, we've got all of our applications that sit on-site. That's why they call it on-premises, aptly named, right? And then we have the firewall, and then from there, that's how we get to the internet, right? That's all on-premises, right? Whereas the public cloud, we take all of our resources, right? We take all of our resources, and they're on the internet, right? Well, how do we get to them, you would wonder, right? Obviously, we get to the internet, right? We get to the internet, right? We might have some resources on site still, but then we got to get through the public, we got to go through the firewall, get to the internet, and then get to our applications. You would think, well, what would be, isn't that going to like, you're going to be dependent on the internet to get to some of your resources? Yes, but at the same time, when we do this, it provides kind of like security. It also provides vulnerabilities as well. So there's pros and cons to it. But there's also, like, let's say, God forbid, we have that proverbial fire, or, you know, a bus hits you, or you know, an earthquake comes to our, you know, facilities. Let's say, like, if that happens, right, then all of our resources, we lose it. But if it's in the cloud, it's not really a cloud, then we will still, like, even if our building gets knocked down by an earthquake, we still have our resources and our applications and our databases and our finances still in the cloud somewhere, right? And we can still access them. That's the benefits of using a public cloud. The only thing is, like we said, there's security vulnerabilities. And really, how secure is our stuff in the cloud, right? Because we have somebody else that's kind of like storing our, you know, data, right? How do we know what kind of audits they're creating? How do we know what kind of security? You know, we just had a breach with SolarWinds, right? So, you know, how secure is your stuff in the cloud? That's the kind of pros and cons you got to, you know, take into consideration, whether you want to keep your stuff on site versus on the cloud in the public. And finally, we've got the private cloud, where you can kind of like, it's kind of like the same thing as a public cloud, right? But with a private cloud, the cloud provider and the cloud consumer are part of the same company. So it's like, we have a remote data center, right, that we access to get our resources. So when we need to access our SQL databases or our finances or whatever, we got to go to the internet to get to it. But it's our stuff that we are hosting, right? It's just that it's our data center. We're not going to, like, I don't know, Cloudflare or some kind of other, you know, cloud computing company and to access our resources. So it's a bit more secure, but, you know, we keep our stuff internally. It's just on the cloud. So even if, you know, we have that earthquake that take down our facilities, our data and our finances and stuff like that, our applications are still safeguarded in the cloud. It's just that this time it's our cloud. That is all I got for y'all today. That is my Twitter handle. That is my YouTube page. And that is my IG. I'm starting to do a little bit more, you know, a little bit more social media. I try to stay away from it, but I realize the importance of it when it comes to try to promote my brand. Follow on me on either of those social media platforms if you want to connect with me on a more personal level. If you have any kind of constructive criticism, or if you like my, you know, teaching style or whatever, whatever, you know, leave a comment below. If you don't, take your hating ass off my channel. If you, you know, like this video, please hit that like button. Hit me with that subscribe button if you want to see some more of this stuff. Like I said, this is kind of like stuff we just wanted to subscribe. I know I said I wanted to do hands-on for each of the topics, but, you know, if y'all want to see some hands-on for something like this, let me know. Leave a comment below, and I'll, you know, maybe I'll spin up a packet tracer or, you know, any kind of GNS3 lab, and maybe we'll, you know, discover the 3-tier versus the 2-tier. I'm not going to, you know, create no cloud for you. Actually, we could create a cloud using GNS3 or any other kind of, you know, simulator or emulator applications. But anyways, for now, please comment, like, subscribe to the network.